Hi everyone, it's Tracy Caruso, and today we're going to be discussing The Tattooist of Auschwitz. I'm so excited and glad that you guys like this book. It's I was a little late to the game on with this one. I didn't read it until this year, and I don't really know why I didn't read it, because I'm Jewish. I had Holocaust survivors in my family, and you would think that I would have just jumped all over this bestseller, but I didn't. But now I am so glad. I thought that I had kind of read them all, and what's going to be the difference with this one. But you know, it's never really like that. You read something and you get a whole other thing. And one of the things that we're going to be getting into the discussion of, and I knew this a little bit before reading it, which is might be why I kind of was unsure about it, is it's based on a story. It's not really completely true. So, you know, there's so many stories from the Holocaust that are the truth when you read them. So, and they're very good. They're very interesting, and you learn a lot. So I was a little unsure about going into the story, but this had a lot of merit in its own right for many reasons. It was just a beautiful love story on top of everything else, albeit a sad one. And I'm really glad that I went down this road, and I'm kind of looking forward to the other two books in the series that I haven't read yet. I was a little afraid that if I read the other two books in the series, that I would kind of mix them in with this one before our discussion. So that'll be sort of my 22 reads. And maybe even if you guys like that one, maybe that can be one of our future ones, if you guys like that idea, and you'll tell me. I also want to point out that Tammy can give you guys my email address later on. And if you have any feedback or things that you'd like to see or ideas or anything, let me know, and we'll make them happen for our meetings. So I'm going to go with what you guys want, what you're interested in. So The Tattoo of Auschwitz was written by Heather Morris in 2018, and it's based on the story of, I believe you pronounce it, Lale Sokolov, and he was born Ludwig Eisenberg. He was a Slovakian Jew and a Holocaust survivor. The book, which was Morris's debut novel, it was originally written as a screenplay. I don't know if you guys know that, but it was originally a screenplay. And Morris was proposed the idea of telling the story of Lale Sokolov by a mutual friend of hers and Lale's son after Lale's wife, Gita, died. Morris met with Lale for 3 years until his death. They had a pretty extensive relationship. He died in 2006. And she heard during this time the story about his time with Gita in Auschwitz, and she was taking notes for her screenplay. During the meetings with Lale, he told Morris about the trauma, pain, and survivor guilt he experienced. We hear a lot. We've read a lot of things about survivor guilt over the years. And I even saw it with some people in my own family. Sadly, a lot of people with the survivor guilt end up committing suicide, but Lale did not, and he was able to really tell his story, which I think is amazing. 6 years after the first meeting with Lale, Morris's sister-in-law suggested writing the story as a book. Her first screenplay was optioned by an Academy Award-winning writer, Pamela Wallace, who did Witness. The Tattooist of Auschwitz was originally written as a screenplay, and it inspired by a competition of readers, Heather Morris embarked on a Kickstarter campaign to raise funds to self-publish her story as a novel. And from there, she came to the attention of an Australian publisher, and the book was published. Later on, the book received a lot of criticism due to historical inaccuracies, and she ended up actually even having a falling out with a lot of people over this, including the family member. The movie is supposed to be made of this book, and I don't think it's ever going to see the light of day. I don't think it's something that's ever going to happen. Unfortunate, but true, and it's because so many people have issues with it, and believe it or not, there are lawsuits going on with this. So eventually, what might even be more interesting than the movie of this would be a movie about the lawsuits and the story revolved around this and what's true and what's not and what came about with that. So we'll have to see what happens. Heather's novel about opens in the Auschwitz concentration camp during World War II. As a young man, Lale tattoos the numbers 34902 onto the arm of a young woman. By the way, that's part of what kicked off this thing with it being inaccurate. They say that when Gita would have been at the camp, it would have been only into the four numbers, not the five numbers, and that there's no possible way that this was her number. And what Heather Morris claims is that this was actually how it was told to her. This is what he said was the number. And, you know, that's possible. I mean, memory is a strange thing. You would think that that might be deeply embedded into him because it was made to be such an important part of the story, but it's really hard to tell. Why would the wrong number be used? But that was one of the things that kicked off the issues they ended up having ultimately. As their eyes meet, Lale and Gita, he's instantly smitten. The story then recedes into time to show Lale's journey to this point, how he arrived at Auschwitz II, Birkenau, in April 1942, along with countless other terrified young Slovakian Jewish men, how he suffered from typhus fever and only survived because of the kindness of his bunkmates, and how he became an apprentice to Pepin, the tattooist responsible for inscribing unique identification numbers into the skin of each new prisoner. By July, Lale and Pepin have tattooed the arms of countless new prisoners, and Lale has vowed that he will resist the Nazis by surviving the camp. At this point, the novel has come full circle, and the scene described in the prologue is repeated again, word for word. Lale tattoos prisoner 34902 and falls in love with her at first sight, which is the prevailing theme of this book. After Pepin mysteriously disappears, Lale is promoted to head tattooer and receives privileges such as better lodgings and extra rations, which he kindly distributes to fellow prisoners. Over time, Lale develops a complicated sort of friendship with a character named Beretsky, the young guard that keeps watch over him and has the authority to end his life at any moment. Pretty scary concept. Beretsky is crude and violent, but he's humanized by being characterized as uneducated and by being given a sympathetic backstory. With the help of Beretsky, Lale writes to the beautiful young prisoner he encountered, and they finally meet. He learns that her name is Gita, but she refuses to tell him her surname or her hometown. She's lost hope for her future and thinks of herself only as prisoner 34902 of Birkenau. Their relationship quickly evolves into a passionate love affair, and Lale encourages Gita to believe in their future together. Their love gives them the motivation that they need to survive, and they become integral in each other's happiness. They watch over one another and offer each other support, help, and comfort that each of them needs. Industrious and bold, Lale creates a network of smugglers within Auschwitz. The girls, I thought that was a very interesting part of this too. The girls that sort through the prisoners' confiscated goods bring him jewels. He uses these jewels to pay village laborers that sneak in food and medicine for him, which he in turn uses as currency for bribery and distributes among those in need. The working and living conditions at Auschwitz are horrendous, and Lale is stupefied by the way that human beings are treated at the hands of the SS that oversee the concentration and extermination camp. The prisoners are worked like slaves, building new blocks and crematorium, and Lale witnesses the extermination of countless innocent lives within the camp's walls. A large group of Romani people are brought to the camp, and they are lodged in Lale's block. This becomes known as the, quote, gypsy camp, and Lale is fascinated by their nomadic lifestyle, and he becomes an honorary member of this close-knit community. They begin to feel like an extended family to him. Meanwhile, Lale becomes acquainted with the sickeningly cruel Dr. Mengele, who inspects each prisoner to determine their fate, selecting who will be put to work, who will be useful for human experimentation, and who should be extinguished right away. When the SS guards discover Lale has been hoarding smuggled jewels and food under his mattress, he is tossed into the interrogation cell, beaten and imprisoned. Due to the connections he has made and the kindness he has shown to others, he manages to escape execution. And after a stint working as a laborer, he secures his old job again and resumes his previous routine. He's devastated when he discovers that the gypsy camp has been emptied and the men, women, and children he had come to consider family have been murdered. That was a very devastating part of the story, I thought. Finally, after 2.5 years of excruciating life at Birkenau, witnessing the worst humanity, rumors of an uprising circulate. And when news reaches the camp of the advancing Russian army, the SS officers hurry to destroy their records and transfer the prisoners. Gita is marched out of the gates with thousands of other female prisoners, and just on time shouts back to Lale that her full name is Gita Furman and that she loves him. She escapes from the guards, finds refuge in a nearby village, and eventually makes her way to Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia, where she joins other camp survivors. Meanwhile, Lale finds himself on a train on his way to another labor camp. He escapes through the forest in a freezing river, only to be captured by Russian soldiers and forced to work for them as their pimp. After several weeks, he's able to gain their trust and uses this as an opportunity to escape. He makes his way to Bratislava. Time stands still as Gita and Lale cross paths on the street and recognize each other. The story closes as Lale asks Gita to marry him and they walk away, one young couple among many in a war-ravaged city. After the story closes, the author's voice takes over the narrative voice and she provides a historical note that gives the readers an overview of the lives of Lale and Gita, two real Holocaust survivors that this fictional account is based on. After the war, they married and they had a child named Gary and they immigrated to Melbourne. To conclude, an afterword written by Gary, the son himself, provides a moving firsthand testament to the love he witnessed between his parents growing up. So I would say that the main theme of this novel is really the triumph of love. And I think it's the motivation that keeps the characters going. The novel demonstrates how the myths of horror and violence, love can triumph above all, and it can give you hope and motivate you to continue to carry on. The author creates a vivid picture of a place that is defined by horror, yet within the scene, she paints a love story that leaves the reader with a sense of hope. You know, as I mentioned right in the beginning, this is a standalone book, but Heather Morris has written two other novels that are considered to be part of a trilogy. The second one is Silke's Journey, and the next one is a recent one that came out called Three Sisters, and both of them are based on true stories. Silke's a powerful character that we meet in The Tattooist of Auschwitz, if you remember. She's the one that they had everybody shave their heads, but Silke, for example, was one of the ones who was allowed to keep her beautiful hair, and it was because she was being used by a Nazi soldier. They described some violent rape scenes in it, and we saw that it broke her spirit, but she's an interesting character. You know, she is described by Lale as a hero. He looks at her as a hero because in his view, he comes to view being a hero as anyone who chooses to survive. So she's chosen to survive and move on. Now, one of the reasons why another discrepancy about this book is, again, Silke is based on a real person. And according to that family, she was supposedly never attacked and never raped, and that a lot of these things never happened to her. But the reality is that we all know from hearing stories about the Holocaust, a lot of these things did happen to people. So it wasn't an unrealistic, whether it happened to her or not, it's not an unrealistic thing that wasn't known to happen. It really did happen. So let's talk a little bit about Auschwitz. Auschwitz was a concentration camp in Poland, 1942 to 1945. I don't know if any of you have ever been to Poland. I have. I went a few years ago. I visited Auschwitz. Wow, is it powerful. And I think it's very interesting, but until recent years, it was just kind of an abandoned place, and it's only quite recently that they've made it into the historical place that it is for people to really go and visit and see, get an idea of more what's going on. So it's used for history, and many children in schools are sent there each year to learn and see what happened and really get more of a feel for this and experience it, which I think is a wonderful thing. It's very dismal, though. I don't even know the fact that anyone can make it through there. I mean, just walking around and looking at it, it's sad, it's dismal, it's hopeless. And the fact that anyone survived it is, to me, absolutely miraculous. So the majority of the novel actually takes place within the walls of Auschwitz, and which is a network of concentration and extermination camps. Thousands of male and female prisoners, mostly Jewish, but not all, as we saw from the Romani part of the story, were brought to the camp for labor, experimentation, and extermination within the gas chambers. Over the course of the novel, the concentration camp is developed architecturally, and new blocks and crematoriums are added. And this setting is depicted as it was when I saw it, as dark, chilling, and unbelievably violent. Auschwitz II, Birkenau, is the camp within the Auschwitz network that the characters in the novel are sent to. It acts as both a concentration and extermination camp, and thousands of Jewish men and women are tortured and killed there. The characters must fight to survive each day as they labor surrounded by electrified fences under the watch of SS officers and undergo inspection and experimentation by Dr. Mengele. But the prisoners that live, they manage to live and survive. Unbelievable. So I'd like to start going into discussion, and then I think we can go into some more of the characters themselves. I want to point out again that this was going to be a movie, and the initial announcement to make it into a movie was 2018. There's been a number of problems that have arisen, starting with the claims about the historical accuracies, but most recently in February of 2020, there were reports that author Heather Morris and her publisher were potentially to be sued with the connection to the book and the sequel, which is Silke's Journey. The family of Silke, which her name was really Cecilia Kavakova Nee Klein, so she was really Cecilia Klein. She's the real life survivor that the character Silke was based on, and she's been upset with her portrayal. She appears as a character in both novels and the book, and she's depicted as being raped, as I mentioned, and treated as a sex slave by the SS officers, all of which historians and her family have alleged to be false. While none of this means that an adaptation to a series of movies can't happen, the problematic aspects of the book may deter this project from going forward. And given the hostility to the book from both the Auschwitz Memorial Research Center, they've gotten involved with it too, and the family members, the characters based on it, probably doesn't bode well for an adaptation. Which brings me to my first question. Does knowing that this book has controversy change your feeling about the book? Anyone? Oh, okay, I see Missy. I think I'm gonna need some of your help, Tammy, because I think only you can unmute them. Is she there? There we go. Okay, Miss Missy.
Okay. No, it actually, I read the book a long time ago, and it's considered fiction. Okay. I think it's ridiculous that it's not a historical book. And it's one man's memory. And he was 87 years old when he started to do this project. He waited until his wife passed away. And the thing, they make an issue about her number was not the correct number, but Gita was very, in the different research I did, she was very upset with the number and hid it most of her life. And when she was in her 60s, she had the number removed from her arm. So the fact that the man is 87 years old and doesn't remember the exact number to me, doesn't make any difference. The book, to me, I've read many Holocaust stories, nonfiction and fiction. And the way I describe it, it's the most beautiful love story in the most horrible situation.
Absolutely. And I agree with you. And, you know, one of the things is that you brought up, which I think is so true, is the idea of memory. I mean, the man is 87 years old, and something that we probably all never really think about is anytime we talk about something that's happened to us, that is actually a memory, and it's been altered in some way, even if we don't realize it, even if it just happened yesterday. It's never going to be 100% accurate. And what she told him and what she wrote down, remember, the author wasn't there. She's going by his story. That's what it is. It's a story of his memories. And there's validity in that, even if it's not 100% of everything that actually happened. Missy.
One of the things when I was researching for the book club was that the people that were negative about it were comparing it, well, this doesn't compare anything like Elie Wiesel's night. Well, it wasn't supposed to be Elie Wiesel's night. Mm-hmm. And so I don't understand how they could be negative about it. How many other books have we read that are just the people's memories? Mm-hmm. We don't research every detail of it. I think it was that this book became so popular that they decided that they were going to criticize the different parts of it.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right. I think that might be part of it, the popularity, and that it became so mainstream. But, you know, even if it's not 100% accurate, if this book is what made it more mainstream for a lot of, you know, and it brought Holocaust interest and knowledge to people who didn't have it before, that is so valuable. That is an incredibly valuable thing. So who cares if it was 100%, you know, or not? I am very, very with you, Missy. And I've got another question for you guys. You know that Gita, you know how Gita doesn't tell Lale during the whole time that they're in there? She won't tell him too many identifying things about herself. She doesn't tell him his last name. We know that that's the last thing she does, is she shouts out her full name to him. And you know, and where she lives, so that he knows something. Is there a reason? I mean, this has to do with identity and the idea of identity in the novel. Why do you think that she does this? That she doesn't tell him this throughout their time together? Let's see.
Ruth, I unmute. Ruth. Okay,
there you are, Ruth.
Well, she didn't. She probably didn't believe she was going to survive, and she lived like it's a fairy tale. If she doesn't tell him her last name, the fairy tales doesn't end. This was a way of surviving. But if I may go on about Auschwitz, you said you were there. What got me, the only part of the book that really where I became clutched, and I'm going to give you a bit of history here, is when I found out that Gita and her friends worked in Canada. Mm. That was the depot for all the belongings that people brought into the camp. And it upset me. It always upsets me because the dream was to be able to go to Canada, the real country from which I come from. And this was a part of the history that was buried in Canada, the real country. There was a gentleman in charge of immigration to Canada, and his name was Blair. And he had a line that he did not want Jewish immigration before or during the Second World War. And he wrote in a document, "None is too many." Mm-hmm. And it wasn't till after the war. There was a professor at York University by the name of, Anyway, he wrote a book and the title was None Is Too Many. Mm-hmm. And his wife came from Poland. Her parents were Holocaust survivors. Mm-hmm. Her father was a very well-respected lawyer in Poland. So I read this and I said to myself, imagine living in those horrid surroundings and naming a depot Canada. I mean, like, it's the end of the dream. I mean, mm-hmm. you've ended up in an extermination camp. It's the end of the dream. Anyway, that part of the story was always touched me. Mm-hmm. The other part was Victor and Yuri. Mm-hmm. And you were there in the Polish countryside. Mm-hmm. People lived around Auschwitz. As a matter of fact, there are accounts of they could actually smell and the ash that came out of the crematoria. I mean, those people were as complicit, although I don't know what they could have done, but they knew what was going on. But do you think it sort of stretches the imagination that Yuri and Victor, would cooperate with Lala? I kept reading it. They were as much in peril as mm-hmm. he was if they were caught. Mm-hmm. And every time I read about his transaction with them, these are the parts of the story that I said I could see the girls bringing Lala the whatever mm-hmm. they found that was worthwhile. And I could see him hoarding food and sharing it with people. Mm-hmm. But that part of the story raised questions in my mind because it was very, very dangerous for them.
You know what? I can see that, you know, Ruth, and it's interesting that you say that because one of the things that I noticed when I was at Auschwitz was I felt that a lot of the people who lived there and lived in the area really distanced themselves from it and were very, very quick to say that they knew nothing and that it was their fault and that was not their fault. I mean, this is now, we're only talking, this was 2019 that I went there. And that was the kind of thing that I was hearing. And it's like, you had no clue, you had no idea. Like they want to distance themselves from it as quickly as possible and not be complicit. Do I think that most people that would be in a camp would actually really help people and this and that? No, I think most of them would really save their own butts. I mean, if we're hearing all of these years later, people who were not there themselves, but they don't want to even admit that maybe part of their family members were there or that people knew, like you can't even get people to admit this now. So I find that hard to believe. To remind everyone who Ruth is talking about, Victor and Yuri were two characters in this book. They're Polish civilian construction workers who work at Birkenau. Victor is the elder. They don't make it clear. I'd love to know what you guys think, but Yuri may either be his son or younger brother. I kept thinking son, but they weren't.
I thought son too.
Yeah, that's what it seemed to me, but they weren't very clear about it. Victor's immediately compassionate towards Lala, though Yuri takes some time to warm up to him. Victor reprimands him for being rude to him. Victor gives Lala food and the three soon strike up a business partnership. That part's believable if people think they can get something. Victor and Yuri bring Lala food and supplies, which he then shares with the other prisoners. And he brings Victor and Yuri contraband in return, money, jewels, and other items smuggled out of Canada, the Canada warehouse, by his friends. So that's who Victor and Yuri are. And do we think, I mean, was this just artistic license to throw something in as a way to do it? Or do we think, I mean, how many people there were like that? If they had gotten caught doing any of this, that's the end of them. So
and the other, I just want to finish the discussion mm-hmm. with Beretsky. Mm-hmm. So you know, this is a young guy, uneducated, mm-hmm. and he wanted to get away from home. Mm-hmm. He's actually a very tragic figure mm-hmm. because he was as victimized as the Jews. Mm-hmm. He ran away to Germany. He joined the Nazi party. He thought he was doing something great. It gave him status. And he ended up as an SS guard mm-hmm. in Auschwitz, dehumanized. As much as, you know, you like to think of what happened to Jews, but look at this, what happened to this young man, completely dehumanized. And I remember when I was reading about him, thinking to myself, this is what happens when you dance with the devil. Mm-hmm. You know, there were moments in this book that you say to yourself, oh my God, you know, look what happened to these people. The other thing that I'd like to comment upon, I took a course out of Melton, and it was called Zachor, Remembrance. And Poland, if you know, this is why it's kind of important to talk about Poland. Poland was actually victimized. They didn't build the concentration camps. All of this, all of the knowledge and the expertise came from Germany. Mm-hmm. And they put it on, they thought so little of the Slavs and so highly of themselves, the Germans, that they built the concentration camp in Poland. Mm-hmm. And then the Russians are coming. And what do the Germans do? They're as guilty as hell and they know it. Mm-hmm. The Polish people, and Poland today has a Yiddish theater. I mean, mm-hmm. it boggles the mind. They are teaching Holocaust and a Jewish civilization in their universities. They don't even have Jews anymore.
Yeah, so you're totally right. I mean, when I was there, I went to where, you know, like, you know, the Jewish ghetto where they still have some of the, you know, things in Krakow, and they have like a bakery there and they have all this stuff. It's almost like I don't even know how to explain this. It's sort of like theater. Like no one there who's working in these places are Jewish. There aren't any Jewish people there. And they have this going on. So you see some of the, you know, the relics and the remnants you can see like, you know, pieces from a cemetery. You can see, you know, these things are there, but you're right. None of it is, it's like this made up, it's almost like a weird Disneyland version of something that they plop in there for their tourists.
Well, they have the same problem, the Poles, as the Jews have. Mm-hmm. What do you remember of your history? Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, right now, they are becoming very, very nationalistic mm-hmm. again. So God knows what's going to happen there. But, you know, I don't like read. I have to tell you, I do not like reading Holocaust literature. I find mm-hmm. it too painful. I mean, it's true what Missy said. You read it as a novel. Mm-hmm. And maybe in that sense, I mean, she created this love story and they survived. The tragedy is they only had the one son. Mm-hmm. And, but hopefully they had a happy life together, such mm-hmm. as they could. And in Melbourne, Australia, as far away from Europe as you could possibly imagine. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there are many aspects of this story that I would appreciate. Do I think it is good literature? Would I have chosen this book as a read for a book club? Mm-hmm. I have to say the answer for me personally. It's me personally. Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think a lot has been said about the Holocaust. I don't want to read any more of it, but because I belong to your book club, I said, I'll go on, read it. But you know what? But when you read about the Yuris and the Victors and the Beretskys, mm-hmm. you have to remind yourself that people find themselves in impossible situations on both sides. Mm-hmm. And not that I sympathize with Beretsky and to allow himself to go this route, but he was dehumanized the moment he went to Germany and mm-hmm. became part of the Nazi Party.
Mm-hmm.
His fate was sealed. Yeah, and I was wondering what in the world happened to him in the end. Like, where did he die? Did he, you know, like, so maybe in a way, Heather, the author, did create something that was worth considering. Anyway, I will shut up now.
No. I think what you're saying is valuable. And the fact is that, okay, so in terms of the book choices that we have for all the things coming up, I tried to pick as many different genres and different kinds of ideas as we could get. And believe me, I know that in terms of a Holocaust book, this might be, it's a little hard to take, but it's not dry. And if you look at it the way Missy says, I looked at this book in certain ways, it's very hopeful. I mean, it's a story where, you know, it's really his story, right? And the fact that he's an old man who lived his life telling his story about it, he survived. So, you know, I think we all like kind of a good survival story. What I also think is interesting is some of the characters that they had, I wonder if Heather Morris made it that some of the characters that were made to be a little more sympathetic, even though they were Nazis and then they helped them, they took care of it, is the idea that I've noticed over the years that when you're trying to do something that's a Holocaust story, whether it's a movie or a book, and they're trying to make it appeal to a whole audience of all different kinds of diverse people, that they feel the need to make it that that other people that are not, let's say, not Jewish in this case, are redeeming characters. I think they think that it's the only way that the general public will accept it. That's the feeling that I've always gotten for it. So that's one idea. To remind everyone who Beretsky was in this story, in case you don't, because I know there's a lot of different names, Beretsky was the SS officer from Romania who was assigned to be Lalej's minder. He seems to both resent the fact that Lalej is a prisoner. He occupies an important political role in the camp, and that puts him almost above Beretsky. So even though he was the one minding him, he was almost a little jealous of him. That's how he was depicted. On the other hand, he seems to harbor a sort of respect for him, for Lalej. And he even seems to care for him at times. He's only a year younger than Lalej, but his childish nature makes him seem much younger. Beretsky is frequently described as sadistic and is prone to bouts of anger, especially when hungover. So he was, you know, I found him to be sympathetic at times, but at other times I looked at his character and he was like, in a way, the most frightening of all. When somebody's unpredictable, you know, he's described as an unpredictable character, you don't know how they're going to work. And he's basically, you know, the Lalej characters constantly throughout the story, he's trying to survive and make sure that he lives another day. So to deal with it. So that was an interesting character in terms of that, showing how he, another way that he had to navigate his way through the camp and be able to survive. But I do see what you're saying a lot about these Holocaust stories. I think if you look at it as not just another Holocaust story, as a more generalized thing that is fictionalized, that really concentrates on the love story aspect of it, you got something more hopeful about it, which is good. It's a little bit of a redeeming part to the whole thing.
As I was listening to you, mm-hmm. a thought occurred to me about Silke, and mm-hmm. it wasn't Beretsky was just a soldier. Mm-hmm. But Silke's, I don't know what to call him, was, I don't know if he raped her or he was her lover. Yeah. I mean, he allowed her and he could control her life. She mm-hmm. had her hair. I don't know what her family is thinking, mm-hmm. that why she would survive with her hair intact. Mm-hmm. But the family is probably mortified mm-hmm. that he was her lover and mm-hmm. that maybe he mm-hmm. cared for her. And, you know, at the end, I just saw a documentary about what happened at the end of the Second World War in France to the women who had relationships with the German soldiers. You know, everybody forgets in war that people are still people. The barriers are all down.
Yeah.
And so are social norms.
You know,
people do what they have to do to survive. And Silke did. Now, she might not like the way she's portrayed, and the family might be, you know, embarrassed because it appears that she collaborated.
Yes.
But she wasn't a collaborator. I mean, no, you do
have to survive. That's what she's described even by Lala as she's a hero because she did what she had to do to survive. The way they describe the character of the man in here, his name was Schwarzhuber. I didn't remember that until I read up on it. Schwarzhuber is a high-ranking SS officer in Birkenau. He's described as a man whose soul has died and whose body is waiting to catch up with it. He graphically rapes Silke in Chapter 9 and pursues a sexual relationship with her for most of the novel.
Oh, I forgot that.
Yeah. It was dark. That's when they start describing those chapters about how she really lost her spirit. She didn't have the sparkle anymore. She's just kind of dragging along. At Silke's request, he has Lolly transferred back to the tattooist job after he is weakened from Jacob's torture. So, you know, when you hear that part of the story, you sort of see that, you know, that kind of like, you know, literary thing, you know, as a redeeming thing for her character, even though I think nobody would have looked at this character as somebody who was bad in any way. She's doing, you know, she's just doing what she has to do, but that something came of it by her being able to at least use some of that connection to be able to help someone else. But, you know, everything that, you know, I've read and seen and stories that I've heard over the years, you know, as Ruth said, usually those relationships were collaborations. I mean, you know, a lot of them fell in love with each other. It's a very strange thing. I mean, anything to survive and go on. And I guess if you don't have enough food to eat, if you think you can start looking at it, it's almost like Stockholm syndrome. You can start looking at this person who's raping you and really keeping you a prisoner as, wow, but they're feeding me and they're protecting me. You could start to look at it that way as a way to survive. And that would be an interesting, that's why that book, I don't know. Have any of you read Silke's journey? Has anyone read it? I haven't read it either, but I'm curious to see where they go from that story. I know a lot of people who've told me that they like that one even better. So, you know, it might be interesting to read it and see, you know, what happened. And that brings me to a question. Survival in the camp depended on people doing deeds of questionable morality. This is a prime example, right? So does anyone think that any of her choices, Gita's choices, the ultimate wife, do you think that any of her choices affected her survival? Do we see her doing anything? I see a lot of eyes going back and forth. I see an ear. All right.
Oh, that's a shame.
Maybe not. Maybe her choices didn't. You know, maybe you don't see it as that way. I mean, we do see the choices of the friend who befriended the Nazi.
Yeah, we don't really see much of her. You know, I mean, we don't hear much of her. You know, she goes back to her room. She stays still. You know, we don't really. We only see her and learn about her when she's with Lael. So, we don't know. I guess her best choice was that she met him and she stayed with him. Like, that was probably the best, safest choice that she could have made. That it's really the one that we see, is that she had him in her life and she, hopefully that she followed exactly what he told her to do. But other than that, we didn't hear much. So that other book that you're talking about, I guess we get to see what happened.
Get to see what happened with Silke. I've got a question for you. One of the themes in this book is also the idea about to save One is to save the world. Again, to save one is to save the world. Do you agree with this statement? Do you see it that way? Hard to see you all.
I do, because there's no way you can save everybody. Mm-hmm. And in whatever situation you're in, but if you can put yourself out of your comfort zone, I mean, that's why when you talk about the different guards, I like to think that there's humanity even in the guards somewhere. Some of them, of course, they're not human at all, but there was people with some humanity in them that maybe just for one day they helped somebody, and not the entire 3 years that Lala was in the camp, but just for a couple days that somebody helped them.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
Schneider, I unmuted you, Mrs. Schneider, if you wanted to talk. I wasn't sure.
No, I'm just looking, seeing who's here and listening to everybody's comments.
Good, I like that. So, okay, so I have a question. Lala and Gita, we know that they met in the camp. We know their story and what happened. Do any of you think that they would have ended up together if they had met in a more ordinary and normal circumstance of just real life? Would these two characters have ended up together?
Mrs. Levitan, I guess. Yep. Anybody?
Oh, no, I just, okay. I'll answer. Probably not.
Mm-hmm.
Because she lived in a different town. He was, the impression I got, maybe I'm wrong, but when, from the start of the novel, he was sort of a man about town. And she wasn't that type of person. Probably not. That's what they talk about life, fate and timing in life, you know? Mm-hmm. So your fate is to end up in Auschwitz, and the timing is that he was the Tattooist and she was standing in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way I sort of look at it.
I see it the way you do. I think that people often end up together because of timing, circumstances, and often shared similar experiences. This is, I know, for example, I know a couple who, it's very interesting. The husband was a priest. The wife was a nun. They both decided to go into ordinary life, and they met each other in a group that was for other people who had, it was for people who were no longer priests and nuns, to kind of acclimate to real life and be able to talk about the unique situation of, you know, how they're resolving their ideas of what it is in life. And these two people met through that group. And, you know, they're married to this day, and this is the life that that they live. And under ordinary circumstances, I don't think that the two of them would be together, but they shared such an unusual and unique experience that they have a bond that others may hear about and empathize with, but can't necessarily understand. And I think that's a lot of what you really see here in this circumstance. So, you know, the thing I want to tell you guys is there's so many things about the Holocaust and so many different books, movies. I have a personal favorite that I recommend, that I would recommend to all of you. And it's actually was something that was a series. I think it came out in the 80s. It was called Holocaust. Has anyone seen this one? It was with Meryl Streep.
Yeah.
Oh,
no, it wasn't Sophie's Choice.
No, Sophie's Choice had Meryl Streep, but so did Holocaust. It was a 10-part series. Tova Feldshaw was in it. There was a big thing. But the reason why that particular one, I think, is very good, that, you know, if you show, you know, to watch and to show kids, grandkids, anyone that you think might want to learn about this. I thought it was very interesting because a lot of Holocaust things that we read and see, they start taking place, like, let's say, pretty much from the moment that they're taken away. And then they go, like, it'll start like on a train or just right at that moment. But this story starts out when they're just living their lives. And it's about a family, and the father is a doctor. And it starts out with them, and they're living a very, he's successful. The family is just living a normal life. They're not particularly religious. They're just living the way you see all of your friends living, thinking that nothing like this could ever happen to them. And then what you start to see is you watch their rights very slowly being taken away from them. And then next thing you know, the father isn't allowed to practice as a doctor. He's not allowed to work with anyone who isn't Jewish. And you see a scene where their housekeeper goes through the wife's closet and takes all her stuff. And she's like, what do you think you're going to do about it? Like, you see it, everything is eroding and everything taken away. And then it builds up to their time of when they go to a camp and when they're separated and all of their stories and what happens to them. And it's very, very fascinating. It's very fascinating to me. The part that really stuck with me was seeing what their lives were like before and how something like this could unfold in a way that would be insidious and that you wouldn't notice. It's not right away. It's not, you know, all of a sudden you're fine one day and then you're not. You can see why there were people who didn't want to leave or didn't think it would happen. And it's a very, very good depiction of it. So I highly recommend that one, Holocaust. Do any of you have recommendations for things that you think that people should see, read, anything else?
You know what, we had a little book club. No, we didn't. We had a lecture last night, and they said they were talking about book banning, and they said Angela's Ashes was one of the books, and The Diary of Anne Frank was, there were two books that were banned. Mm. Certainly. So, yes, Mrs. Edelman, you were there.
There was a very interesting series, and unfortunately, I can't remember the name of it, but I'll tell you about it. It was about this hospital in Germany. Mm-hmm. And the focus is the hospital and what happens when the Germans come in and take over the hospital, and how in one instance, a marriage breaks up because the child of the German couple is imperfect, and the husband wants to send the child away, and the wife rescues the child, and then it has a dimension of a Jewish family. And so it had different elements in it, which made it quite interesting. The hospital is a very famous one, and it's still in Germany. I think it was in East Berlin.
Wow. Well, if you end up remembering, you know, what that is, either send me a message or send it to Tammy. I would love for all of us to be able to check this out.
I Googled, there's one called Fog in August. There's the In Darkness. The Best of Men. This would be maybe Mrs. Edelman about the, there's one about a boy placed in a mental hospital.
No.
And then there's one called like Charlie at War.
No.
Okay. Well, I tried to look when you guys.
I've got one more that I thought was very interesting that a Danish friend of mine recommended to me a number of years ago called Europa. And it's not, did anyone see that? That was absolutely amazing. An amazing, amazing story. And it's another one that I highly recommend. Hard to find though now and hard to get. I don't know why, but it is, because I've tried to get it for people before. I wanted my husband to see it, and I'm like, I couldn't find it. So if you can find it, that's definitely a really good one. My husband's not Jewish, so for me, I once in a while, I feel like that's my way of contributing to his knowledge of these things. so that we keep it going. He's in the Florida House passing a lot of Jewish legislation. So to me, it's important for him to have the feeling of all of these things, and in a way that he can take it and absorb it and get it, you know. So if it's more mainstream, like a Schindler's List, that's fine too. But I thought that a Europa would be a really, really good one for him. So are you guys excited about our next book?
Tracy, before we leave, the name of that hospital is called Charité, and I'm not pronouncing it correct. And there were two episodes. There was one right before the war, and Louis Pasteur was mentioned and so forth. So that was historical with science. And then you have the World War II one, both involving this hospital. Very, very interesting.
Wow. Well, if you could send the spelling of that to Tammy or send it to me, that would
be great. I'll put it in the link. I saw it, and I was one of the things I said, but I probably pronounced it wrong. But it looks like Charité is actually on Netflix, possibly.
Oh, good. Even better.
I'm on the computer with book club.
I love anything that you can get on Netflix. So are you guys excited for the next book, which is going to be a totally different thing, Empire Pain? And that one will try to give you a lot of historical backgrounds on that, especially since I think that the opioid epidemic is such a big part of our lives here in Florida. I think it's going to be a particularly interesting read. And that one was also on Barack Obama's book list. So I think that we're all going to find this one very interesting. And it's nonfiction. So that's also a different thing. And then you guys will tell me if you're like, you know what, I never want to see a nonfiction one in book club again. You'll be able to tell me that too. So we'll be able to find out all of those things. But I really think it reads very much like just a riveting story. And the story of the Sackler dynasty has become a very interesting one that they now have other shows about on Netflix. There's one called Dope Sick. Don't look at those though before reading your book. Don't cheat.